Dear Lord, we come before you this morning with praise in our hearts. And we thank you, God, for your presence today. We come to bless your name and to see you high and lifted up. It is always our intention, Lord, that when we come together as your people, is to lift the name of Jesus Christ. I pray, God, for your blessing as I teach and preach your word today. Thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit that is moving in the midst of us now. And thank you, God, for each person gathered here today. Those who came for the first time, and those who faithfully come, Lord, to worship you through Holy Ground Family Fellowship. So, Lord, blessing and honor be to your name. In Jesus' wonderful name I pray. Amen and amen. Glory to God. Are you happy, church?
Amen.
Are you blessed?
Amen.
And you look blessed from this, from the pulpit, you look blessed. Amen. And I'm blessed too. And my family is blessed too. Hallelujah. Well, last Sunday, we talked about the visit of the Magi or the wise men. And from that visit, we learned some valuable truth that these wise men demonstrated, particularly in their gift offered to the child Jesus. They gave precious gifts worthy of the one they came to see. They offered gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Their gifts were expression of their generosity. And I believe that this truth is applicable and relevant for us today. These wise men remind us of God's generosity. Amen. God has been generous to all of us, to the church, to your families. God has been generous to us. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 says, Ephesians 1, 7, it says there, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. Generous in his grace. We're here today because of God's generous grace that he lavished on us. Not only that, but God also is generous in his love. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3, it says there, see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Amen? So what great love God has lavished on us. Lavish means without limit. Generous, no bound, lavish. And it is out of God's great love that he gave us perfect gifts. We read that in James chapter 12, verse 17, that says, every good and perfect gift comes from above. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. Now, last week I shared about seven perfect gifts of God to us. First is his son. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Amen? Jesus is God's perfect gift to us. And we have Christmas because of that wonderful gift that God gave us. Eternal life is another gift. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Salvation is another wonderful gift, another perfect gift God gave to us. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, we are saved through faith by grace. We're saved by grace through faith. It is not yourselves, it is the gift of God. Salvation is a gift from God. The Holy Spirit is another gift sent by the Father. Amen. The spiritual gifts that St. Paul mentioned, that each one of you has your own gift from God. Another one is the grace of God in Ephesians 1:7, the riches of His grace that He loveth on us. And the seventh is the Word of God. This is God's wonderful gift to us. We know Him because of the Bible. Amen? Hallelujah. So these are God's wonderful gifts given to us. And all these gifts flows from the greatness of God's love. God demonstrated His love to us through His gifts. They say that you can give without loving, but you can't love without giving. And so God gave us gifts that flows from His great love to us. Now, church, it is a fact that gifts are tangible demonstration of our love and appreciation. Do you agree? Gifts are tangible demonstration of our love and appreciations. You know, kids may not understand the motivation behind the gift they receive. They're just overwhelmed with excitement. But for us adults, we see beyond the gift. We see the thoughtfulness. We see the appreciation. We see the love that the giver is extending to us. And that encourages the receiver of that gift. May God's generosity inspire us to be generous as well. Amen? Now, my question is, what could be a generous gift we can give to God? What could be a generous gift you and I can give to God? Now, the psalmist David, he said, "What can I give back to God for the blessings He's poured out on me?" Amen. Could be one praise. Okay? What can I give back to God for the blessings He's poured out on me? Shopping and finding the right gift to buy is a little bit stressful to me. But here's a suggestion from one person. He said, "What not to buy your wife?" Husbands, listen. Maybe finding the right gift for your wife is driving you crazy. And it's how many days more, and it's going to be Christmas Day. But here's a suggestion from one person. What not to buy your wife? Although the only person a man usually shops for is his wife, the whole experience is a stressful one. Many a man has felt extreme frigid temperature for a long period based on a poor present decision. As a veteran of these wars, I'm still not sure what to buy my wife, but I pass on what not to buy her. Number one, don't buy anything that plugs in. Anything that requires electricity is seen as utilitarian. Don't buy anything that involves sizes. The chances are 1 in 7,000 that you will not get her size right. And your wife will be offended the other 6,999 times. "Do I look like a size 16? She'll say. "Too small a size doesn't cut it either. I haven't worn size 8 in 20 years. Another suggestion. Avoid all things useful. The new silver palace advertised to save hundreds of hours is not going to win you any brownie points. Number four, don't buy anything that involves weight loss or self-improvement. She'll perceive a 6-month membership to diet center as a suggestion that she's overweight. Don't buy jewelry. The jewelry your wife wants, you can't afford. And the jewelry you can't afford, she doesn't want. I think I'm a victim of that too. And guys, do not fall into the traditional trap of buying her frilly underwear. Your idea of the kind your wife should wear and what she actually wears are light years apart. And finally, don't spend too much. How do you think we're going to afford that? She'll ask. But don't spend too little. She won't say anything, but she'll think, is that all I'm worth? Good suggestions. I'll just give my wife cash to play safe. Hallelujah. But really, what could be a generous gift we can give to God? Okay. Hallelujah. What can we give back to God for the blessing He's poured on us so lavishly, so generously? Well, we know that God doesn't need anything from us because He owns everything, right? But I believe what God wants from us is our willingness to serve Him with the gifts and talents He has given us. Amen. Let me say it again. I believe what God wants from us is your and my willingness to serve others with the gifts and talents that God has given us. Because the reality is, as we serve Him, or we serve Him by serving others. We minister to God by ministering to others. Amen. Amen, church. Hallelujah. As we serve Him, we serve others. When we give gifts to somebody or to others, it is really our gift to God. It is really our gift to God. And Jesus underscored this in Matthew chapter 25, verse 34 to 40. 35 to 40. And let me read to you the word of God. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. Verse 37. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick and or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did to for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. Did you get a church? Did you get a church? You did it for me. We can say that the righteous, the person who does what is right, are giving gifts to the needy, gifts of food and drink to the hungry, gifts of hospitality to the strangers, gift of clothes to those in need, gift of compassion to those who are sick and in prison. And unknowingly, they did it for the Lord. Unknowingly, they did it for the Lord. That's what he asked, Lord, when did we? The Lord said, because you did it the least of my brethren, my brothers and sisters, you did it for me. In contrast, let us read verses 42 to 45. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you did not look after me. They also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you? He will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Amen. Clearly, clear as the day, Jesus is teaching us the serving God is by serving others. Ministering to God is by ministering to others. But one thing we cannot do, we cannot worship God by worshiping others. That's idolatry. Amen, church. Now, the context of this verse is in verse 31 to 33 of Matthew chapter 25. Let me read to you again. When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, He will sit on His glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates a sheep and from the goats. He will put the sheep on His right and the goats on His left. What is the scenario that is given here? There's going to be a judgment day. Then all of us will stand before the Lord, and the great judge will separate the sheep from the goats. The sheep represents those who serve others and actually is serving God. And the goats represents those who do not serve others and actually is not serving God. Simple, amen. Simple. Finally, the destination of both is in verse 46 of Matthew 25, verse 46. He says there, then they, who is they? The goats. Will go away to eternal punishment, right? But the righteous to eternal life. So there is eternal punishment, and there is also eternal life. The sheep will be in eternal life, and the goats will go away to eternal punishment. So we serve others, or we serve God by serving others. We minister to God by ministering to others. We love God by loving others. Are you with me? Because if you have done this in the list of my brethren, you've done it for me. Now in response to God's generosity, let us be generous in paying Him back by serving others through our treasure, talents, and time. Last Sunday, the first series of the sermon, I talked about generosity with our treasure, with an underlying principle that God will generously match your generosity. Amen. That God will match your generosity with His generosity, based from the analogy that St. Paul laid to us in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, says there, about the farmer who only plants a few seeds will get a few crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. But today, I want to encourage you to be generous in your talents. Are you with me? Today, I want to encourage you to be generous in your talents. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7, the Apostle Paul said, 1 Corinthians 4, 7, 7 says, I wish that all of you were as I am, but each of you has your own gift from God. One has this gift, another has that. Hallelujah. I don't know how many people are seated here in this worship time. I want you to know, based from the Bible, that each of you has your own gift from God. Amen. Did you hear me, church? Maybe out of lack of knowledge, you say, I'm not gifted. I can't do anything for the church. I can't do anything for the body of Christ. I don't have any gift at all. I'm only a mere church attendee. No, the Bible said each one of us here today has a gift from God. One has this and one has that. As children of God, each one of us receive a gift from God, and God expects us to use that gift in serving one another, in our ministry, and in our mission. Ministry is our ministry to the body of Christ, our service to the members of the body of Christ. To the church, your church ministry, that is your ministry. Mission is our work to the world in winning souls for Christ, in evangelism, in our outreach, in our missions program. We do that based from the gift that God is giving us. Hallelujah. God's requirement for us as we use our gift is faithfulness. Did you hear me, church? In the expense, in the dispense of our gift, of our talents, you know, church, God requires us to remain faithful. To me, faithful is simple. Meaning, if your gift is needed in the body of Christ or by anyone in need, you are there, willing and making time to serve according to your gifts. Amen. A faithful person is always there, willing to serve. Many times, we don't see this. Because when there is an opportunity to serve, we look it right away through the natural eyes, through our soul. So we see, it's too hard a job. It's too much work. I'm too busy for that. I mean, no, I can't do that. We see the natural, we see in the human level. But if we see it beyond that and see it through the spiritual eyes, that is your opportunity to serve God, you will be motivated to say, yes, I volunteer. Because I'm doing this not unto men, but as unto God. That is opportunity, is a God-given opportunity, not to serve anybody or for myself, but an opportunity to serve my God. Amen. It was so difficult for you to say, no, I'm sorry, I don't have time. If you see it as service to God, not to man. So you look beyond the natural and see that this is indeed as unto the Lord. Now, Jesus in the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25 teaches this requirement of faithfulness. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 14 to 30, the story is about a man who went on a journey. So he entrusted his properties to his servants. To one, he gave 5 talents, or 5 bags of gold. A talent is worth more than 1,000. But the Bible says, the first one, he gave 5 bags of gold. To the second servant, he gave 2 bags of gold. And to the third servant, he gave 1 bag of gold. The one who received 5 went out right away and put to work the money and gained 5 more bags of gold. The same thing with the servant with 2 bags. He went right away and went back and earned 2 bags more of gold. But the one who received 1 bag of gold, he went out indeed, yes, he went, but he dug a hole and hid the money. And for a long time, the master came back and did an accounting. First servant, what happened? Oh, good sir, I earned 5 bags of gold more. Good, faithful servant. And the second one too, Lord, I earned 2 more bags of gold. Good servant. The third one, sir, I know they're very strict and you do accounting. So instead, I dug a hole and hid the bag. And Lord, here it is, still intact. 1. And the master said, you lazy and wicked servant. And you know the story. I was thrown into the darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. The parable of the talents warns us that our place and service in heaven will depend on the faithfulness of our lives and service here. A talent represents our abilities, time, resources, and opportunities to serve God while on earth. I want you to hear that again. A talent represents our abilities, time, resources, and opportunities to serve God while on earth. These things are considered by God as trust that we are responsible to administer in the wisest possible way. And if you will study the parable, you will understand that whatever we receive from God as a talent must be put to work in order for it to grow. Did you hear me? From this talent, from this parable of the talents, we understand now that whatever we receive from God must be put to work, must be put to action in order for it to grow. Because if you don't use it, you lose it, so to say. In Matthew 25, 16, says there from the King James Version, says, "Then he that hath received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them other 5 talents. Well, the other translation says, "The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more." The key, he went out and put his money to work and he gained 5 more bags of gold. This man gained 5 more not just by sitting and appreciating the glitter of the gold, you know, that he received, but he went out and invested his money wisely. The same with the other man who got 2 talents. He put his money to work and gained another 2 more. But contrary to the one who received 1 talent or 1 bag of gold, he dug a hole and hid the money. Church, in order for your talents to be beneficial to others, it must be put to work. Your talent is not primarily intended for your self-consumption only, but for the edification of the body of Christ. Did you hear me? That's the basic fundamental truth. Your talent is intended to encourage one another, to edify one another. St. Paul in Ephesians chapter 4 was talking about the ministry gifts that God gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the teachers, and the pastors, and this ministry gives work for the edifying of the body of Christ. Amen. Amen. When the body is edified, they're ready for the coming of the Lord. Yes. When the body is encouraged and edified and built up in the faith, hallelujah, when the Lord comes, we are ready for that. Again, from this parable, we understand that there will be an accounting day for all the talents we receive from God. Amen. A day will come that this parable teaches us for an accounting day for all the talents we receive from God. Matthew 25, 19 says, "After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them." Did you read it? After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. There is no definite time. It's going to be 5 years or 6 years. He said, for a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. I noticed as I was studying this parable that they're only accountable with the talents that we received, and everything is accounted for. Amen. The man with 5 gained 5 more, all accounted for. The man with 2 gained 2 more, all accounted for. The man who got 1, who was accounted but gained nothing because he didn't do anything about it, he dug a hole and hid it. Just I want you to know that during the accounting day, it is about what we have done with the talents God has given us. Amen. It is about what we have done. Did you hear me, church? With the talents that God has given us, are you serving others with your talents? Have you ushered souls to His kingdom with your talents? Have you encouraged those who are down with your talents? Has the church been blessed with your talents? Again, from this parable, we understand that God's requirement in the practice of our talents is faithfulness. Amen. Faithfulness. Church, faithfulness is tested by time. Time will tell if you are faithful or not. If you notice, the master in this parable took a long time to return and settled accounts with his servant. The spirit of faithfulness is for long terms. Did you hear me? For long terms. I don't know if you read, but in Yahoo News recently, a few or several weeks ago, a picture of a Chinese couple went viral. They were married in 1945. And in 2005, they went back to the same spot they got married and reenacted the wedding day. And this year, 2015, the same couple went back again to the same spot of the wedding and again reenacted the wedding day. And both of them are 98 years old. And they were planning when they turn 100 years old, they'll go back to the same spot to do the wedding. To me, that is faithfulness to one another. Hello. That's faithfulness. Almost 100 years. Husband and wife. Now, 1 year, that's it. Faithfulness in this case is tested by time. We understand from the parable that trustworthiness begins by being trusted with few things. Did you hear my church? From this parable, we understand that trustworthiness begins by being trusted with few things. And Matthew 25, 21 says, his master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Hallelujah. You good and faithful servant, he said. In Luke chapter 16, verse 10 says, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches of heaven? Amen. Amen. So trustworthiness begins by being trusted with few things. It is a principle, right? How can we be faithful with big things when we are not even faithful with small things? Many times we despise small beginning, as the servant did. He only got one talent. And maybe he thought, what could I do with one? So he dug a hole and hid it. But the Bible says, despise not small beginning. Amen? Because as we prove ourselves faithful, promotion comes from the Lord. Promotion is not from the east or from the west, or from the south, or from the north. Promotion comes from the Lord. But as we prove faithful in small beginning, in a small ministry that God has trusted you, if you improve yourself, if you remain faithful in that, God will give us the promotion. Amen, church. We understand from this parable that God rewards faithfulness. God will not overlook or bypass your faithfulness. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share with your master's happiness. I just want to share you some blessings of the faithful that I discover from the word of the Lord. And I trust that this will truly encourage you to remain faithful in God. The faithful will be richly blessed. The faithful will be richly blessed. Proverbs 20:20, a faithful person will be richly blessed. The faithful will be protected and guarded. Proverbs 2:8, for he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful one. Hallelujah. The faithful will experience the faithfulness of God. Psalms 18:25, to the faithful you show yourself faithful. The faithful will enjoy peace. In Psalms 85 verse 8, he promises peace to his people, his faithful servants. to the faithful, God will watch over, hallelujah, them, will watch over them. In Psalms 101, verse 6, my eyes will be on the faithful in the land, that they may dwell with me. And you know what, church? The faithful, in Psalms 116, verse 15, will be welcomed in the hour of his death. The Bible said, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. The Message translation says, when they arrive at the gates of death, God welcome those who love him. Amen? When they arrive at the gates of death, God welcomes those who love him. Therefore, be faithful in serving the Lord with your talents, that are your abilities, time, resources, and opportunities. Because to serve God is to serve others. Amen? And we know that one day, you and I will stand before the judgment seat of God. Amen. Appear before him to receive our rewards. Your generous service of your talents will be generously rewarded. Remember that God will generously match your generosity. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 9:6 tells us, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Amen. Can I hear amen? Louder than that. Amen. Hallelujah. God will match your generosity. Remember this. Don't forget this. Remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whosoever sows generously will also reap generously. I mean, it makes sense, right? Using the analogy of the farmer. If the farmer is stingy in planting his seeds, he will only have also a stingy crop. But if the farmer is lavish in planting his seeds, then the time will come that he will have lavish harvest of what he planted. It makes sense. 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to bless you abundantly. Hallelujah. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. From this translation, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, did you hear me, church? In all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. This is the promise of God. In response to your generosity with your treasure and with your talent as you serve one another, glory to God. I'm standing on these promises of the Lord. 2 Corinthians 9:10 to 11 says, now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way, so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Give him glory, church. Do you believe these words? Amen. Are you seeing this through the eyes of faith? That God will do this to you who is very generous. He said, now, not in the future. Amen? Today, now is a time element in this verse. Now, God will supply your needs. Now, God will give you the increase. Now, God will meet everything and every time and all your needs. Now, he said here, He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. And the verse 11, you will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. Meaning, God will prosper you so you can be more generous. Thank you, Lord. Who is the founder of Facebook? A few months ago, he's giving millions of his income to charity. I said $45 million, if my memory serves me right. Wow. Billions. $45 billion. Wow, 99% of his stock. He's giving it all away. And he's only 30-something years old. Woo! He was prosperous so he can be generous also in giving to others. Remember what I said last Sunday? That God will bless you so much to have leftovers so that with your leftovers you can share more. Don't get me wrong, I'm not against saving. But sometimes we're so stuck on savings that we close our mind and our hearts to sharing. Are you with me? In my case, in my situation, every time we have extra, there will always be somebody who will come to us and have a need. And I cannot just say no, because at the back of my window, we have still savings. I cannot have that principle, don't touch your savings. No matter what, don't touch your savings. When I have the knowledge that my brother is hungry, I can't stop them. I can't do it. I can't stop it. Release. I was reminded by Mommy Terry last Sunday, and I forgot about it, but now I remember it. When season the Lord came to us one day, she was crying because she will be ejected from her house, from her apartment, because she can't pay for her apartment. And I asked her, how much do you need, sister? She said, my rental is $800. $800. Oh, I have $1,000 in my savings. So I gave $800. So she won't be ejected from her apartment. Please don't come to me, huh? I'm not promoting it. Hello? Don't take your chances, Pastor might have savings. But I did. And God has been so generous back to us. Amen? And finally, Revelation 22 verse 12 says, look, I'm coming soon. Amen? It took a long time for the master to return and to the accounting. But also the Lord says in Revelation 22:12, look, I'm coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to each person according to what they have done. Amen? I want you to know, church, that God will not overlook your generosity. You'll never go wrong with generosity. God will honor it. So, church, when there's an opportunity for the body of Christ to serve others, see it beyond the natural. Amen? Don't see it like, oh, I have no time. Oh, I'm too busy. Oh, that and that, this and that. Take it as an opportunity, because as you serve one another, you're actually serving God. When somebody is thirsty and hungry, don't turn your back when you have water and food to spare, because you are not doing it unto him, but as unto the Lord. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we want to stay focused in the true essence of Christmas. You gave lavishly. You lavish us out of your great love and the riches of your grace. Let this time of the year, God, remind us of your generosity and inspire us to be generous as well. Father, I believe, based from your words, that each one of us has received a gift from you. And Peter admonished us, O God, Lord, to serve one another with the gift that we received from you. That he said, each one of you must serve one another with the gift that you receive from God. And I pray, God, that let us be generous with our talents. That we will not grumble or complain, O God, when we are needed because of the talents and the gifts that you have given us for the expansion and advancement of your kingdom and for your glory and for your honor. God, help us to see beyond the natural. Help us to see that as we do it to the least of my brethren, you're doing it as unto me, Jesus said. If you're doing it to them, you're not doing it to me. Help us to remember what David said, how can I pay back the Lord? O our God, who has poured out so much blessings on us. Today, the message, Lord, the essence of the message is we can pay Him back by being generous with our talents in serving others. We can pay You back, O God, hallelujah, in the practical way we're serving others with the gifts and talents that you have bestowed us. There are needs, Lord, among your people. And some of us here with the gift of hospitality, the gift of giving, ministry of giving, of compassion, the gift of encouragement as an intercessor to pray. So, Lord, thank you very much for this wonderful gift given to us. Let the Magi, O God, who visited Jesus, the child Jesus, inspire us, God, in the spirit of generosity in this time of the year and every year. They gave precious gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, because the one who received the gift is worthy. O Lord, you are worthy, O God. We give you back the glory, the honor, and praises. O giver of every good and perfect gift, we glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.